Today, we are going to be talking about heaven and hell. Now, in older mythologies, heaven is described as a mountain where the gods reside. In Greek mythology, the mountain is called Mount Olympus. And not just in Greece, but heaven in general, in older mythology at least, the mountain is described as being in the sky. Now, when we go to the book of Genesis, the moon was never said to have been created. It never mentions the moon in there. Now, why am I mentioning that? And what does that have anything to do with what I just said? Well, let's go to the Mesopotamian religion real quick, because they also described, well, the Mesopotamian religions described heaven as being a mountain as well. And they also said that gods reside there. And with that mountain that they call heaven being in the sky, and when we take a look at the sky, we don't see a mountain. Or do we? Let me put this in another way. Mountain in the sky. How about a mountain sitting on the sky? When we take a look at the sky, the only type of rock, the only rock that we actually see, not just type, but the only rock that we see is the moon. And the moon was viewed by ancient cultures as an unreachable destination, which is an unreachable place. And as I was saying earlier, in the book of Genesis, heaven and earth are mentioned as being created, but the moon is not mentioned. It's because heaven is the moon. Now, what do you think about that? What do you think, Silver Sir?
I can see that how they viewed that as a place, because at the time there was no way that they could reach it. So, they thought that the moon was too mean and reaching paradise or something like that, or that they were very curious in astrology, where the moon was at and the sun, stars, and planets.
Yeah, and when we take a look at hell now, hell is basically a fear-mongering concept in which if you don't believe in something, you're going to go there. Now, when we take a look at Christianity in particular, Christians believe in a hell. And Islam derived their belief of hell from Christianity. And hell is viewed as a place of punishment, eternal punishment, for not believing in the so-called correct God. Now, what do you think about that?
I think that's an all-knowing God would make that happen. What even? To come up with that type of plan would be ridiculous. Like, just because you believe in a wrong religion,
right,
that you have to suffer eternally forever, I think that's a nonsense.
Exactly.
It's not even fair.
And they often say that, don't you want to avoid taking the risk that you are wrong and that God actually exists when you die? And basically they say that to people that don't think that God exists. And the thing is, they don't understand that they're already taking that risk. With your logic about having faith that, that God exists, then by faith, other people also believe. They also other people also believe in their gods by faith. So which one is right and which one is wrong? Can you tell the difference? You can't. And they pretend, they try to make themselves think that they can by saying that, well, the other gods are created beings, so they're just false idols that are made up. You see, they're skeptical of other religions, but they're not skeptical of their own religion. And they don't think that, oh, what if my God is the wrong one? I might be going to somebody else's punishment or hell. So what do you think about that?
Yeah, I think they are taking a risk because there's 4,200 religions there. There's 30,000 sects of Christianity. All have their own version of God and a custom of belief. So by you not looking for other religions to see if they're right, you're wrong, and you're taking a big risk.
Exactly. And the thing is, when we go back to heaven, I mean, take a look at the concept of heaven. It's basically it's some type of hope for an eternal afterlife after someone dies, and it'll be peaceful. It'll be pretty awesome, and all those things, and hell. Still meaning that you'll have eternal afterlife, eternal life after death, but you'll be feeling pain for eternity and torment and a cessation of fire burning in hell forever for worshiping the wrong God, apparently. And the thing is, when you take a look at Christianity and Judaism, the one thing that's very different between the two is the fact that in Judaism there is no hell, but in Christianity there is a hell. So what do you think about that?
So in Judaism, I know they believe in heaven, but why they don't believe in hell? What's their reason?
They call death Sheol.
So pretty much is that Judaism's like pretty much is that like the Old Testament of the Bible?
It's like the
oral law, something like that, or?
Well, they believe in the Hebrew scriptures, or what the Christians call the Old Testament. Pretty much every book of the Bible except for the books of the New Testament. You get me?
Yes.
And, yeah. So what do you think about the hell concept in Christianity?
I think it's just a big tool to use to get people to conform to a belief system based on fear, though.
Exactly. And the thing is, they try to tell people that if you don't believe in God, you're a sinner. And when you doubt in God and you start to think that maybe God doesn't exist, maybe my religion is not what I thought it was, they call you a sinner. Now let's take a look at the word sin for a moment. Sin is supposed to be an act of evil. But when we go to the Mesopotamian text, there's a god called Sin. He's a god of the moon. He's also a god of knowledge. So sin is a personification of knowledge in the Mesopotamian text, in the Mesopotamian religion at least. And in the Abrahamic religion, sin is evil. It's spelt the exact same way as the Abrahamic word sin. So that's just the thing. It is the same word. And the Mesopotamians had it before Judaism came to exist, into existence. So, when we take a look at the word sin and compare that to the moon god Sin, whom is a god of knowledge as well, put two and two together, and what you find out is that sin is knowledge, and because sin is evil, knowledge is evil. You follow me?
Yes.
Because when you have knowledge, you are no longer ignorant of something. You become aware. They don't want you to become aware. Especially the major religious figures, they don't want you to become aware that you're being conned into believing a religion that's actually a compilation of multiple different myths augmented into a singular book. And it is being advertised as the Word of God. And when you take a look at history to see if you try to find any evidence that a God had anything to do with the Bible, putting it together and all that, all you get is that humans put it together. You don't have any evidence of an outside entity. So what do you think about that?
Yeah, we have no evidence that it's so bound with it. Said that this is his work before the man has been. Oh, man, said that.
Exactly. And the thing is, they claim that the Bible is inspired by God. And the thing is, our religions say that they got their thing from a God. So which one got it right? Again, you fall back to faith. You gotta have faith.
I think it all goes down to, I think in the scripture, I think you mentioned before, Deuteronomy, where it says that God came down and confused the language of men. Could that be one of the reasons why we have different religions?
You mean the book of Genesis?
Yeah, Genesis, I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's fine. Well, basically, they just say why there's more than one language is because God confused the tongues of man during the Tower of Babel incident. And the thing is, it's obviously something that was made up to explain why other languages exist, because when you take a look at religion, it preys on the ignorant. You follow me?
Yes.
And the thing is, the Bible was made by it's just when you look at the Bible, it is made to literally con the ignorant into believing in superstitious nonsense. And every day, like if you believe in God, there are Christians that they don't fear going to hell. They think that just by belief they'll go to heaven. They don't have to worry about any actions that they do in life. But there are also other Christians out there that do think that they have to control themselves every day. You follow me?
Yes.
There are different interpretations of the Bible. There's like 30,000 different denominations of Christianity. You have Bible translations that don't agree with each other. The scriptures in the Bible constantly contradict each other. And you have 30,000 denominations of Christianity. And yet they all say that the Bible is the Word of God. It's perfect and there is no inconsistency. There's obviously an inconsistency if there's 30,000 different denominations of Christianity. And they don't think about that. They just don't. And the thing is, going back to what that was being talked about earlier is that when you look at the claims that they're making, they're always trying to make sure that they cover all the dots, that they, and in the sense that they do it by faith. You get me?
Yes.
So, like, if you say that, well, does the other God, what, like, there's a risk that your God might be wrong, somebody else's God is true, they'll just come at you and say, well, that God is either a created being or it's fake and it never existed. Again, you're believing that by faith.
Oh, wait, let me stop you there. I remember Matt made a good point on this. He says that if faith leads you to utter gods who are not like gods, then he said that faith cannot be it's not a highway to truth. But would you agree on that?
Yes, I absolutely agree. Absolutely. It is not a reliable pathway to truth.
Because it can get you to the wrong and right God. So how do you find the right? How do you find absolute truth?
Well, if you even, like, if you really want to, if you really care about truth and you don't take, and you don't want to take things by faith, then it's gonna, then you better start researching. Check out multiple different sources, get confirmation about things, research history, and stop listening to religious people for answers. Because they're just going to give you lame answers. And often they'll also give you information that's inaccurate and that is not actually part of history. You get me?
Yes.
And people don't think about that. They really don't. So, is there anything else you want to talk about?
Hold on. I'm about to read this thing on here. I want you to see. I want you to agree what I'm about to say.
Okay.
It's on this page right here. It says, "Afterlife contacts show no signs of hell." So pretty much what they're saying is that there's been people. Like, I'll just read it. It says that we also have a vast storehouse of records from people that have had a spontaneous after-death communication with deceased loved ones, induced after-death experiences, and psychotherapist offices and near-death experiences, as well as thousands of reports from mediums about the afterlife and recordings of those in afterlife speaking with the aid of direct voice mediums. None of these reports about the afterlife has anything about a hell. A small number of near-death experiences have had inconsistent experiences that were negative, but they still don't match the hell methodology, material realm reactions to trauma, or no glimpses of the afterlife. Would you agree with me on that?
Yeah, because one way or another, you cannot prove somebody's personal experience. You just, you can't. You can't prove it. And the thing is, when religions claim that I had that they had a new that somebody had a near death experience, therefore my God exists, they all make those claims. Or at least a lot of them make those claims. That's not proof. Again, you're accepting by faith. And you're also having faith that that person didn't hallucinate. Because when the brain hears something, it can recycle the details of what you heard into an image. You follow me?
Yes.
And you can dream about it. And if you're close to death, there's a chance that you can still have that experience take place. And it's actually fake. It's a construct of the mind. It's not actually a God. It's not anything outside of that paradigm of a dream or hallucination. It just doesn't work. That's not a reliable pathway to truth. It's not. That's a very bad, ridiculous assertion.
Doesn't say in the Bible that you already had an encounter with death once. So how do you not come back in life again?
Exactly, yes. The New Testament doesn't necessarily support near-death experiences. Instead, it says that when somebody dies, that person could be resurrected. You get me?
Yeah, even the Bible doesn't even mention that at all. So a near-life after-death experiences at all. So that's all just wishful thinking.
Right. And the only person, entities that have the power to resurrect somebody is God and Jesus. And the thing is, if you want a near-death experience, you're not necessarily going to get a near-death experience. What you need is somebody that actually dies. Like somebody that really dies and comes back. Now, that like happens. Lazarus? What?
Like Lazarus, right? Lazarus?
Lazarus, yeah, the resurrection of Lazarus. And Jesus said, told him to come out. And he came out. And speaking of Lazarus and the miracles of Jesus, if he really did these miracles, I'm pretty sure it would have circulated very, very fast. If he did, if such a man did exist 2,000 years ago, you follow me?
Yeah.
But it didn't. Instead, the New Testament was written decades after the fact by anonymous authors. We don't know who wrote them. The New Testament did not have the names like Matthew, John, Luke, Mark. Well, the names like that didn't come until later. Until later versions of the Gospels. And people don't think about that now. And when you look at the 12 apostles, there is literally no proof that they exist. That they ever existed. And when you take a look at astrology for a moment, and you look at the zodiac, there's 12 signs. And it sounds a lot like the 12 apostles. So what do you think about all that?
Yeah, 12 signs, and then you got, I was going to say something else. Yeah, it's pretty much based off astrology and other stuff like numerology, yeah, stuff like that.
Exactly. So, with that being said, is there anything else you want to talk about before we close out?
No.
All right, so I think that pretty much covers it.